And up next, we have Brian Gogan talking about Chromecast testing.
Hi, guys. So after all that talk of delicious dumplings and lunch, I'm sure there's some post-food coma setting in, so I'm going to try and make sure that I keep it fast. So my name is Brian Gogan. I'm a software engineer, tools and infrastructure at Google, and I've been lucky enough to be working on Chromecast for the last couple of years. So I'm going to do a little bit of context setting first, just you know, to kind of set the stage. For Chromecast, you know, it's part of, a wider movement that's going on in the industry about Internet of Things. So everybody's kind of aware of this. We have lots more devices being released onto the market, being connected to the Internet, and interoperating with each other. So this is a big test challenge for us. The numbers of devices are pretty big. Right now, we're somewhere around about 5 billion devices in the market. And by 2020, that's expected to grow pretty hugely. So why do we care? Well, software really powers all of these devices. You know, typically there's pretty extensive software stacks running on these devices. And as we all know, software needs testing. So lots of opportunity for us. So Chromecast, just want to kind of give a backgrounder on Chromecast. I think most people hopefully know what Chromecast is. But for those of you that don't, it's a dongle that plugs into the back of your TV, and it allows you to stream content from the internet onto your TV. And that content can be movies, can be TV shows, it can be videos, it can also be music content or photos. So it's kind of a challenging device in several facets. In terms of Internet of Things and how it all fits together, it's kind of a good example of some of the challenges that we face. There are multiple devices talking to each other. In order to get content on your TV, you use your phone. So the phone is your remote control. Therefore, there is communication between the phone and the Chromecast device itself. So you've got a lot of asynchronous communication going on. A lot of challenging things to test. The device itself has been pretty successful. We've sold about 20 million of them. We've got over 1,000 apps in the market, which means it's more and more challenging for us to release new features and make sure that we maintain quality of the ecosystem. So I'm going to talk a little bit about test automation for Chromecast. Talk about some of the challenges that we have faced, and kind of map out some of the future work that we have, not just for Chromecast but for Internet of Things in general. I'm going to focus mostly on device testing because, that's kind of probably the most fun stuff that we do. But, one question that always pops up is, do we use emulators? And the answer is absolutely. Virtualized devices running in the cloud, it's a scalable solution, allows us to do end-to-end testing from, for example, Android phones to Chromecast devices. We put some plumbing together to make sure that they can communicate with each other, and then that gives us a very nice, clean, hermetic test environment. So you get a lot of benefits there, like flakiness elimination. And it's scalable in a couple of senses. One, it's scalable that you can just run, as many servers as you have in the cloud, you can run tests. And then also, it enables internal partners that we have at Google, like YouTube, Play, Photos, to use that infrastructure in their end-to-end testing. So then the question comes up, why would we test on real devices at all? So there are classes of tests where you just have to test on real devices. For example, performance benchmarking, interoperability testing. We have stacks of AV and DRM on the device that we can only test on the actual hardware itself. And there's certain types of bugs as well and issues that will only be found on the device. Largely, these are kind of timing related issues. So the challenge, though, is getting a very good, solid signal-to-noise ratio from your test results. We have a lot of hardware variability, a lot of network variability, and the end result of that is that we have a problem of device management that we need to solve. So I'll talk a little bit about some of those challenges. First of all, our device lab for Chromecast, just kind of put some numbers and context behind it. 450 devices we have under test. That kind of spans the range of different cast-enabled devices that are in the market, including Android TV, Cast for Audio, and the various different generations of Chromecast. Lots of builds coming out per day, millions of test runs, all that good stuff. Lots of Gangnam-style playbacks. We contributed pretty heavily to that. So managing all the devices, what we did for this was to build a tool, our device manager. Now, there's quite a few different tools at Google kind of working towards solving this. We found we had to build one ourselves for a couple of reasons. One, we have some pretty custom setups, which the other solutions in the market or at Google weren't supporting. The other one is that the grouping of devices, we have fairly specific groupings of devices that are necessary for specific types of tests, and we needed to be able to support that. So that's just, you can kind of see there the UI of what the device manager looks like, kind of gives you an idea. So what this device manager does is when a test starts, this manager acts as a broker, it allocates a device to a test, and the test will run on that device for a specific period of time. In terms of stuff that goes wrong, lots of stuff goes wrong. Kind of basic obvious ones are, you know, we don't have enough devices to run tests, so standard capacity issue. You know, we kind of solve that by throwing more hardware at the problem. There's also the variation of test results across devices. We found that there were, you know, even between different revs of the hardware, we would find varying results. So that was really tricky to kind of debug in some cases. You know, we kind of built a lot of traceability of devices into the system so that we could really nail down exactly where differences were and isolate issues. Stuff that goes really wrong, unreliable devices mainly. We've a lot of hardware in the loop, and you know, hardware likes to fry itself or overheat. It likes to disconnect from the network for arbitrary reasons. We also get stuff like kernel bugs, which mean it's really hard to recover the devices. We've also had cases where the MAC addresses of the devices just changed for arbitrary reasons, probably breaking some IEEE rules. Just happens. So countermeasures there, lots of monitoring, lots of logging. Redundancy as well. We threw a lot of hardware at the problem so that if a device does go down, we have redundant backups. And also, before we allocate a device for a test, we'll do some kind of basic sanity checks to validate that you know, this is a reasonable device to use. And then kind of one of the worst case scenarios that we sometimes run into is the kind of the bad build effect, where a device gets a bad build and it bricks the device, and you know, this becomes a pretty virulent cascading effect and pretty quickly takes out the entire lab. Really painful, horrible stuff. You've got to go in there and recover all these devices manually. Not fun, especially when you've got hundreds of devices and trying to trace down the ones that are actually broken. So we've kind of established a quarantine system. Before we push builds onto a wider population of devices, we will push them onto a smaller subset of devices, which are kind of our taste testers of sort. So I think just kind of to summarize in terms of the tooling requirements for just general device management and Internet of Things testing. So device allocation and brokering mechanisms, that's kind of a given. We also need a system to be somewhat device type agnostic, as we're working with various devices interoperating with each other. And plenty of monitoring. Monitoring is super important. So the other kind of major challenge that we face with Chromecast is Wi-Fi. So I'll talk a little bit about some of the challenges here. So the requirements for a good Wi-Fi system or test system are kind of somewhat, you know, counter to each other. Obviously, you want a reliable test signal. You want to isolate away any Wi-Fi interference so that the test is somewhat robust. At the same time, you want to have some level of controlled interference so that when you do run a test, it's actually exercising some of the logic that's on the device for robustness. At the same time, you want to do that in a realistic end-user environment, which is somewhat challenging to generate in a lab. And at the same time, you want to test across a whole bunch of APs. There's, you know, hundreds of APs out there that people are using. And then the kind of holy grail is also to be able to reproduce Wi-Fi issues that happen in the field. That's kind of an overall industry challenge that we have. So like I say, some of those may be mutually exclusive. So our strategy really for this, for attacking this problem, has been to implement various different test beds. We have test beds for these various different environments, and I'll just kind of quickly walk through these. First one is, these are RF isolation boxes that we use. In our test lab, one of the challenges that we have is the Wi-Fi interference from, you know, various other devices that are around. So even if we, you know, if we just have a test running on a device in the lab, it's probably going to be super flaky. So we put the devices into these boxes. These provide about 80 dBs of attenuation and, you know, give us somewhat of a clean test signal. One of the cool things about working at Google is that we have lots of other teams kind of solving similar problems. So the Chrome OS guys have done an amazing job in putting together an interoperability environment where there's 150 plus of the most popular APs on the market in a fully automated setup. So we can drop in our Chromecast devices into this environment. The APs are turned on one hot, so you can communicate with just one AP at a time. And this is what we use for setup testing, for example, on the Chromecast to make sure that it interoperates with these various different APs. This has turned out to be, you know, probably one of our cornerstones of our entire test strategy for Wi-Fi on Chromecast. Let's see. Another kind of environment that we have, so this is less on the automated side, more on the manual test side, is a set of shield rooms that we build. So these are effectively Faraday cages about the size of an office. So we have people in there testing. We have some amount of automation that we do in there, mirroring specifically where we are mirroring from an Android device to a Chromecast. That's a pretty, as far as Wi-Fi is concerned, that's a pretty challenging setup. There's multiple streams going from device to device. So a shield room is very, very useful there. One kind of interesting stress test we can do in there is we start off a mirroring session and then slowly open the door and just watch the mirroring session degrade. It's kind of fun to watch. Another kind of more recent addition to our lab is this Octobox. So this is this is our effort towards a very controlled environment. This equipment gives us a couple of different levers. One is an attenuator, so we'll put a router in one of the chambers and the device under test in the second chamber, and we can vary the attenuation in a very controlled manner. It also has a multipath emulator, which kind of simulates the real-world interference or real-world echoing that happens in a room from an AP to a device. It also allows us some level of interference generation to inject that into the box. So this is, we do some level of automated testing in this, but it's primarily, you know, an experimental setup, which kind of allows us to kind of solve, when we get a new Wi-Fi driver to validate that the quality is there. And the final one that we kind of set up is an emulated network environment. So this has been very useful, for example, with mirroring, where we want to have a very controlled set of environments where we inject a lot of latency or packet loss, and it gives us, you know, good metrics on the quality of the mirroring session. So the device lab, I have some photos to show. When I was talking a little bit earlier about, you know, we get a bad build on a bunch of devices, it's pretty painful to go through. So here is the ugly previous situation. So you can imagine trying to find device number 22 in that mess. Not a lot of fun. We kind of had this ugly beast of a thing, which we anthropomorphized into an animal we call Casty, Nasty Casty. So we spent a lot of time on designing a better setup, and this is kind of what we have now. So lots of, you know, neat features here. A couple, like obviously we've got nice labeling, so you can figure out which device is which. It's all logically laid out. Cool thing here, you can see on the second from top shelf, you can see that we have switches there. Those switches allow us to view the HDMI output of any of the Chromecasts on the rack. So each rack holds 72 Chromecast devices, all running continuous integration testing. Close up there, you can see some of our Gen 1 devices. So you can see how the HDMI connection is there. So that's routed under the shelf and then up to the top screens via the switches. Here you can see kind of the backside of it where we have Ethernet connectivity to all the devices. So that's one other point to note, that all these devices under test are hard connected via Ethernet, which obviously cleans up, makes for more reliable test results. Here you can see the serial connections coming from the bottom of the devices. We have a class of tests as well that require HDMI sinks to be connected to. So it's kind of fun to watch tests running on all these different screens. Here you can see our next generation Chromecast devices connected up. So I have some quick photos of the build out of the lab rack. We kind of came up with this concept, sourced these components, and kind of built out the lab rack as was. So we started off with some cardboard, went from here all the way to a fully fleshed out prototype, and then started building it up on a rack, and then ended up with what we have today. So Opportunities. I think, you know, Internet of Things, like I say, it's a nascent area, especially as far as test engineering is concerned. I think there's a lot of us in this room here who are working on various different approaches to this, but I think it's fair to say that there's no broadly adopted frameworks in the market at the moment. So lots of opportunities for testing in the cloud, for virtualization, interoperability labs. We have emerging standards coming out with Thread, Weave, and various different standards like that. So there are, you know, there is convergence happening, but kind of like I say to my team, you know, we have probably decades of work ahead of us in order to solve these problems. So that's it.
Thank you. And sadly, we don't have time for questions after
all right.
This one.
I used it all up.
Yeah, he decided to use it all up, showing us awesome pictures.